buddy.
These researchers are transferring a wild animal from box trap to bag.
Keep going.
They can't really see it. Come on, buddy. But this critter is always hard to see, especially in Texas.
Down here in the southern part of their range, the densities appear to be pretty low.
What I'm trying to do is get his head in the corner so that it's easier to grab without getting bitten. There we go.
This is one of the smallest species of the wild dog family in North America, a swift fox. And these researchers are happy to find it in good health on this lonesome prairie in the far north panhandle.
First things first, hair dye. Those teeth look smooth.
This team is studying the status of this elusive little fox to help keep it on the grasslands of the Great Plains.
We are Operation Fox Finder. Okay, guys, your maps are ready. My name's Doni Schwalm.
So here's camp.
My job description is research associate.
I'm gonna go a little bit further in the road bend.
At the Department of Fisheries and Wildlife at Oregon State University.
But try and stay south of the road.
We're looking for swift foxes.
There you go.
Very cool.
Okay.
Appreciate it.
We're working with Texas Parks and Wildlife to survey for swift foxes in a 9-county area in the Texas Panhandle that falls within the historic distribution of this species. This species, from what we can tell from historic records, was almost gone. We know for sure there's been a big decline historically. About 50% of their historic distribution now no longer has swift foxes. And where they do still exist, the population is kind of patchy, so it's not very continuous. We think that the first and foremost thing that led to these major population declines were historic predator control programs, where they were poisoning kind of indiscriminately for wolves mostly, and really just anything. And unfortunately, those baits, they're not specific, and we ended up with a lot fewer foxes that way. Of course, they like grassland habitat. The more agricultural development there is, especially if it's like irrigated farmland, the fewer swift foxes there will be. And then finally, primarily because there's no more wolves, there's way more coyotes than there used to be. And coyotes are their highest source of mortality, up to 77% of their mortality. So it's a pretty big deal. Habitat in the Texas Panhandle tends to be centered in like the national grassland system right along the Oklahoma and New Mexico borders, and then quite a bit of private land too. There's a lot of cattle ranchers that have good habitat. They want that short vegetation. I work with a lot of private landowners, and they always want to know if this is going to affect their operation. And the first thing I tell them is that this is not an endangered species. But the second thing is that if they're grazing their pastures, they're doing swift foxes a favor. So the only thing we would ask is, you know, please don't shoot them. What I find is that most private landowners, if they know they have swift foxes, they really like them. They're kind of cute and charismatic.
I'd keep it on this side. So,
all right. We're doing two different things while we're here. Our primary task is to set cameras. But we're also doing some live trapping because we want to collect a genetic sample to look at the genetic viability of this population.
All right, ready for the pull?
Yeah.
Six. I'm doing a grid study with wildlife cameras.
Stop!
16.
What that means is we have multiple wildlife cameras per area rather than just one. That increases the chances of seeing our focal species, the swift fox.
We use a paste bait. It's very, very skunky. Nasty.
Pungent.
The way we've got it set up, we've got a scent post 3 meters out from the camera and a bunch of other smelly stuff near that scent post. And they'll smell the post. Sometimes they'll mark the post. They'll roll in the lure and kind of hang out in front of the camera for a little while and tootle off. Mostly we get coyotes. And badgers and skunks and porcupines and pronghorn and all kinds of birds and all kinds of raptors and crows and vultures and everything but a fox. We must be close to 200 cameras out and zero fox. But we were surveying where they haven't been seen since the 80s, so I can't say we're surprised. I'm gonna be really disappointed if we're setting cameras all in this area where they should be, and we don't get them. So the daily schedule is pretty much all day. As soon as we're done checking our trap line, not today, then we're setting cameras all day long until 3 or 4 in the afternoon and we start resetting our traps. Yeah, I don't know. It's not really an exact science. How dry is the brisket, Sean? Maybe if we can get ourselves a roadkill deer, the rest of the brisket will go in our bellies.
Oh, gosh.
The glories of wildlife biology. Only put the rabbit in a spot that you think is just amazing. Let's get some foxes in boxes. We're gonna go back to that really short stuff. So this is a really exciting place to set traps. The vegetation is almost like a golf course. They like it 6 inches or less, and this is probably some of the best stuff that we've found so far since it's a wet year.
Maybe.
Everything's so tall.
Here.
Okay. There we go. You got all the GPS and stuff?
Yep.
Okay, we're done. I think we've got a good chance of a fox. Still no fox sign though, which is a bummer. Lots of coyote tracks and some coyote scats. So, we'll see. But put our last two right around here. There's a little prairie dog town over there and some trails, so fingers crossed. I'm excited. We got enough sunlight left to get home in time to cook something instead of just eat cold soup.
Even though the swift fox is not federally endangered, it's still a species of concern that we want to help. Their habitat is going away and they don't have anywhere to live. And so I'm hoping that as we talk with the public and help them understand what is happening, they can help with our efforts.
29 degrees this morning. You gotta take your time or you're gonna leave your oil pan somewhere in the middle of a pasture. Nobody came to say hello. So this one's empty. Shoot! There's another one down there. You know, they talk about this like a flyover land, and I always like, oh, that's because you haven't spent any time in it. You don't listen to the meadowlark chorus in the morning, so I think they're missing out. Grasslands are so underappreciated because there's a lot of really unique species here that occur here and nowhere else. We've lost a lot of it, but there's a lot of opportunity left to like conserve these unusual species that only occur here. Ooh, there's a closed.
Oh, it does look closed.
It's closed. Okay, the moment of truth. Please don't be a skunk. This one has me nervous. It's a fox. It's a fox. And he tore part of the plastic off the trap so I could see him. All right, we got one. Let's text the crew.
To be able to see one in hand is really rewarding. You're really surprised at how small they are.
2.3 kilograms. Female? It's like the fox's version of alien abduction. Probed and prodded and measured.
2 inches.
To keep the eyes covered, they stay kind of calm, and there's no evidence it affects them in the long term. I want to help fix things. I want to work with the landscape, I want to work with the landowners to see if we can like put some things to rights where we can. And swift foxes provide that opportunity to like put something back on the landscape and restore the species, and they're a neat little animal. Alright. They're tough little guys and I can appreciate that. That's the best part. Turn them loose and they always put on a nice little show. Away I go, back to life. Atta girl. Trot off and then they stop and they look at you and have a little bathroom break and go on their way.
All right.
Good luck, honey.
This project was funded in part by a grant from the Wildlife Restoration Program.